Professor Ben Kurtman is with us. He is the professor of atmospheric sciences at the University of Miami. rmas.miami.edu is his website. Professor, welcome to the program.
Well, thank you very much for having me here.
Thanks for joining us. It was interesting. The other day I was debating global climate change with a Republican partisan, and he said, you know, if climate change was real, he said, business people aren't stupid. If climate change was real, you would be seeing the property of beachfront real estate in Miami dropping. But instead, right now, it's rising. In fact, to the point that people are saying it's a bubble. How do we reconcile those two apparent disparate realities?
I'm not so sure they're so disparate. Certainly, you know, currently property is rising and values are rising in Miami. But if you actually look at building codes for how people have to build new properties, they are, at least in the South Florida region, they are having to respond to this sea level rise concern. And if you look at how the city of Miami Beach, for example, is dealing with clear sky flooding that they have every fall, people are clamoring and saying, look, you know, we got to deal with this flooding. We have to figure out how to raise the roads. We have to figure out how to deal with this flooding. So I don't see those two things necessarily being in conflict with each other. Right. Now, at some point in the future, people are going to build property in a place that's going to suffer lots of inundation from sea level rise, and they won't be able to get mortgages. So that's certainly on the horizon, but it doesn't look like it's 30 years away, and that's probably what the mortgage companies are thinking about.
Yeah. Have you ever been to Venice in Italy?
Absolutely, a number of times.
Now, here we have a country. I've been there also several times. It's a beautiful place to visit. And here you have a city that is, as you take the gondolas through what used to be streets, you are looking in the second floor windows of houses.
That's right.
And or the tops of first floor windows. And, the city sank, the water rose, and the city merely adapted. I guess they had the good fortune of this happening around the time that, as the city was electrified, the electrical wires were run on poles or from house to house, so they're all above the water.
That's right.
Miami has most of their electricity below ground, if I'm remembering correct. It's been a while since I've been in Miami. But, you know, could we see cities of the future becoming basically like Venice and gondolas being the new way of transport? Or is there something unique about Venice that allowed them to adadapt that's not going to provide for that for modern cities, and we're just screwed?
No, I can see that exact scenario in Miami Beach's future. In fact, you know, they talk about, I was just at a meeting on Tuesday with the city engineer for Miami Beach was there, and they're talking about, well, how high do I have to put the electrical panels on some of these regions that are, you know, just 2 or 3 feet above sea level? Should I be putting that at 10 feet? People complain because they don't want to be able to see the electric panel so high, but that's the safety zone. And so, the city of Miami Beach is being very proactive and really trying to think about what their city is going to look like in the future. Is it going to be that, a city where public transportation is the only way to get around? You're not going to have cars throughout the streets, and you're going to have limited roads that are raised. And homes are, you know, over time going to, you know, the first floor is basically going to be on stilts. And are you going to see that happen in Miami Beach? So they're wondering about what the long-term future of that city is. And they're committed to maintaining a Miami Beach in the future. This is not a piece of property that's going to be abandoned, and they want to know how they're going to have to do that.
Yeah, well, over the last few decades, much of the new construction along the South Carolina coast and the Outer Islands, I have a friend who lives down in the Keys, all these houses are being built basically on 12 or 14-foot stilts.
Right.
Fairly, large concrete, well-structured stilts, but still, and a lot of this has to do with storm surge and hurricanes, but it'll
That's
serve
right.
them well if there's no more land, assuming
right.
that they have a boat. But in the midst of this, you have a governor, you have 10 scientists. Yesterday,
right.
I saw the story where there's 10 climate scientists who are attempting to have a meeting with Governor Rick Scott to educate him about climate science. He apparently is not interested in that meeting. What is going on there?
Well, you know, basically the 10 of us that signed that letter, our sense is we really don't like this I'm not a scientist explanation for responding to important policy issues.
Well, it goes beyond that. He said, I'm not a scientist, therefore I'm not going to do anything, basically.
Right, differently. So I really want to push.
Isn't that a little bit like saying, you know, my doctor told me I have gonorrhea, but I'm not a scientist, so I'm not going to do anything about it.
Exactly. It's a lot like that. Are you going to listen to the dental hygienist that tells you you need heart bypass surgery? You know, I think it's the responsibility of our policymakers to actually use the best available science in order to inform their decisions. So, you know, in principle, I'm okay with a governor saying that yes, I've ingested the best available science and I've decided that the economic impacts of doing something are just too expensive. That's fair. That's the policy debate that we should be having. But to say that, you know, I'm not a scientist, therefore I'm going to ignore the problem, I think is not what policymakers need to be doing. That I think, to me, is abdicating their responsibilities.
Has the governor weakened at all in his opposition to meeting with you and your 9 colleagues?
Well, I get some media reports, so I got something just a few minutes before this call that Governor Scott has stated that he's willing to have people from his staff meet with us.
Well, that's a start.
That's a start. So, you know, of course, it would be foolish for him to say, you know, politically thinking, I think it would be foolish for him to say, I refuse to meet with these people. You know, that would.
Right. And on the other hand, if he does meet with you and any pictures were taken, Fox News and the Tea Party would take him apart.
Sure. But you know, to say that you're going to completely ignore, you know, the science, to me, it actually seems to, in my mind, seems to violate sort of conservative principles. Conservative principles, you know, I think you want to act conservatively. You want to assess all the risks, and you want to respond conservatively to those risks.
Yeah.
So here we're identifying a legitimate risk to this entire community. And
this is the problem. I realize your area is science, mine is politics. I would say that the, you know, the Tea Party and Fox are, they're not conservatives, they're radicals, reactionaries. In any case, I wish you well in your efforts to educate your governor. Professor Ben Kirkman of the Department of Atmospheric Sciences at the University of Miami. Hang on just a second, sir.
This is the Thom Hartmann Program.
That fellow always steps on me. Thank you so much for being with us, sir.
My pleasure to be here.
Thank you, Professor.